Thanks, everyone. Really excited to be here tonight. And it is my pleasure to welcome one of my favorite actresses. She's had a distinctive, unique career. She's been in some of my favorite TV shows and movies, and I swear I'm not just saying that. Let's bring out Lili Taylor. So I don't know where to start, so let's just start at the beginning. When did you know you wanted to be an actor?
I think when I was like five. I don't know why I wanted to be an actor. So that says that it feels a little bigger than me sometimes, so I just sort of kind of follow, you know.
Were your parents supportive of it?
Very. In fact, they didn't want me to do something 9 to 5 for whatever reason. They were thrilled that I was going outside the Yeah.
So how did you begin to pursue it? What steps did you take?
Well, I had this, I don't know why I got this bias to film, but for some reason I thought stage was more legitimate. At a young age, I guess I became a snob. I don't know why. But so I thought that I only wanted to do stage. So I would like pore over books of, you know, stage stories, stage actors, and the first play was You're a Good Boy, Charlie Brown. And then I did The Princess and the Pea in sixth grade. And then I wanted to audition for Annie, but believe it or not, I was too tall, if you can believe it. I got a voiceover when I was in fifth grade. I put myself into the Shakespeare camp when I was in seventh grade. I was just like, I want training, I want to get good, and then I want to come onto the stage once I have training.
What kind of training did you take?
I was kicked out of school. I was kicked out of, I finally got into a conservatory. I had a great drama teacher in high school. I studied with Joyce Piven from the Piven Theater Workshop in Chicago, fantastic place, mostly Viola Spolin. So we worked with a lot of like theater games. So it was just a lot of joy. I had studied some Stanislavski, of course. And then I went to Goodman of DePaul in Chicago. And we were kind of at odds, and then I needed to just do one day of work to pay for my third quarter on a movie of the week, and they all said yes, except for one teacher who said no. We started to fight. He said, I don't like your attitude. I said, I don't like yours, and we hung up on each other, and he said, don't come back, and that was that. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Not how I wanted it to go, but it's fine. It worked out how it works out, but I mean, everyone's like, but at that time, all I knew, my roommates were going off to school getting training, and I was listening to the Cubs, the day games, you know, I was right near Cubs Wrigley Field, and I felt like I was on the outside, and it didn't feel good.
So how did you get past all of that?
Well, then I met Del Close, who he worked with Belushi, and he worked with a lot of the Saturday Night Live guys. I was in Chicago. I lived right above the Blues Bar, so I was around like Second City. I did improv, which actually isn't my thing. I wasn't very good at all. I really do like a script, so I wasn't very good at all, but he was still very kind to me. And then I started doing theater, but then I got in a fight with Equity, because Equity's really strict in Chicago, and all of the Equity in 87 was, there was 116 non-Equity houses, and only like 12 Equity houses. And all the stuff back then, Chicago was so great with the theater. And they told me they would take my card away forever if they found me doing, I was gonna do a play with Cusack, John Cusack, The New Criminals. And then I went to New York. And that was, and I always knew I wanted to go to New York. And then I found some teachers in New York in theater and so on.
What did you take away from all of those experiences? Was it just your drive that you just knew you wanted to be an actor?
Well, you know, I mean, I do feel that, you know, when people talk to me about acting, it's sort of like if you feel a little ambivalent, I don't know, because it's hard. It's hard. I mean, go for it anyway. I mean, no judgment. But I mean, I just had that thing where I wasn't ambivalent at all, and I don't know why. I just have that. But I think. You know, look, I mean, I'm almost 50, so I've obviously had a life, you know, and I've learned a lot, and, you know, a lot of it's easy to say because it's hindsight, but a couple of things that helped me a lot was learning that I could say no. Which is hard, like especially at 3 a.m. when maybe I wanted to do something that was off Broadway, and yet there was maybe something bigger and more commercial, and they wanted me to do that, but I had wanted to do the other thing, and no one was very happy with my decision, so I'm kind of alone with, you know, this decision at 3 a.m. But it was also important because I felt at least I could sit with myself. You know, I didn't feel good about doing something that I didn't believe in. It didn't make me feel good. And just to know that if there's something that you don't feel good about, you don't have to do it. And I don't believe there's a formula. Like, mm-hmm. a lot of times people were saying, if you do this, then this will happen, and then you'll get that. And I have actually tried that, and it's never worked. It's never worked. And so I just feel like, you know, to thine own self be true. But then a friend of mine said, well, which self? And then, you know, and it's not easy, but just to know, you know, that to say no was an important thing for me to learn, like in my early 20s.
Talk about the training you went through as an actor. Is there some lesson that you took away from that, all that, you know, working with Stanislavski and some of those teachers you mentioned? Is there something that still holds true for you in your career now?
Well, you know, I just brought out the Meisner book again, and I never got to study with Meisner. I never did any Meisner, but I love his technique. And you know, he said, you know, it takes you about 20 years to learn how to act, which I really believe that. But so, like, basically, I always just keep looking and reading and trying to learn and for each job, to really act as if this job is. Whatever might have worked on the last job, let that go. Conversely, though, I have to build up some kind of foundation too. But it's just to clean out, and maybe this next job might ask for maybe not as much preparation, or it might ask for, I don't know what. I have to be open to that and not impose something onto it. But a couple things I've learned is, like, you know, to come up with an amalgam, you know, come up with a smorgasbord, take what you want, leave the rest. You can come up with your own technique. Try things that maybe, you know, I've tried things that I didn't know would work or not and kind of took a risk. And for instance, I started doing these charts because on Independence in the 90s, we were moving so fast and so out of order. And I've found with a really good script, it usually breaks down into 4 parts of the character's journey. And then within that, their beats, you know? And I've started to name those parts that she's going through, sort of trying to distill it into maybe two words. And then to distill all the beats. And then I make a chart. And I name, and it's usually about 120 beats or something like that. And I have that chart, and then if we're jumping around and now I'm in this part of her life, I can just go to that and get clear on where I am. But then that was sort of a risk. Like, I didn't know what the hell I was doing when I was doing that chart, but it was sort of feeling like, okay, I needed some kind of concretization of what I was doing and something to help locate me. But then there's been some things where the chart, no, don't do the chart. That's not what this needs. So it's just to be as open as I can on each project.
Great. So take me back to your career path. So you arrive in New York as an actor. What was your big break? What turned around for you?
Okay, well, so I was in Chicago, and I had gotten my first professional job when I was in high school. So, and that, again, is not how I wanted it to go, because I wanted to go into conservatory, and I knew having an agent going into conservatory was going to be hard, because I said, you know, please don't call me for 4 years, you know. and so, which is not easy. So anyway, I started that, and then I got kicked out pretty fast. And then I got Mystic Pizza, which was one of those that was like, thanks, I know. Who would have known? I mean, I did this, I was like,
how did the job come to you?
Okay, so I was here in LA. I was here visiting my agent here in LA, who also had an agency in Chicago. And I was out here because I was friends with Johnny Cusack and all those Chicago guys, and we were out hanging out. I went in on an audition, And it was one of those movies that was just the catch-22 where they didn't want a name. Even back then there was the name thing, not like there is now, but a little bit back then. Anyways, I passed that catch-22 where I was able to get seen for a lead not being a name. And it just had all those elements that I just was like, okay, I got through that, and that hurdle. And then it happened. So great. Went off and did that. That was great. And then Say Anything with my buddies from Chicago, still was living in Chicago, did something else, and then got in the fight with Equity. And then I came to, but I always knew I wanted.
I'm sensing a theme here.
I know, right? It's like, and then I always wanted to go to New York with a little money in my pocket, and because I knew that New York was hard, and I went with a play. I got Richard Foreman's play, What Did He See? He's an avant-garde director, and it was a perfect way to go to New York. You know, I think for me, I like starting out in a smaller city. And when actors who kind of come to me talking about how to start out, I say, you know, if you can go to a smaller city, just because it's cheaper, it's cheaper, you can do theater. You can keep busy, you can afford your rent, you can take chances. And that race, it's not as oppressing, you know? Chicago was a lot, the business wasn't there, so I didn't have like so much compare and despair, you know? Whereas even, I'm here in LA and I start to feel like, shit, you know? Because it just feels like everybody's working, everybody's amazing, everybody's doing great. And somehow, and even though I might be doing fine myself, it doesn't feel like it. It's very strange. So, so New York can help me a little bit in that department. Just because you're, you know, life's just right there. I don't know. It's just the subway can sort of keep anything real, I guess.
So, was it a conscious decision to try to do stage over film when you were starting out?
Yeah. I think every actor should try to do stage if you can. I mean, I know I've heard Daniel Day-Lewis doesn't like stage at all. He's done one play, he had a heart attack or something, or he's freaked out. So if it's not for you, of course, and it's not like you must do stage to touch your truth. No, it's not like that. It's just, I feel that the stage, getting on the stage does remind me why I'm an actor. It connects me back to something much older and much bigger than me. And I just think anytime someone is reminded of that, it's like a writer should probably take a poetry class if they can, to go back to why language was invented, you know? And so I think it's just really good. And I know that I need to do a play every so often. And it can get hard when, you know, movies can be so sexy and so seemingly more important that it can be easy to forget about theater. And to really make a point and say, I am going away and I'm doing this play. Even though I know you don't give a shit, I know it's not as important. And a lot of times in LA, it sort of feels like, yes, there is theater. Mm. I don't know if you know, but plays are still a big deal out east, you know? So I try to make a point to do a play, yes.
Do you have a favorite role that you've played on the stage?
Lemon, from Aunt Dan and Lemon, Wally Shawn's play. That was a really, really great experience. He's a great playwright. Scott Elliott directed it. It was a very good experience, yeah.
So let's go back to Mystic Pizza. Mm-hmm. Did you have any sense when you were making that it was gonna become the phenomenon that it was?
Not at all. Not at all. No, I didn't. At times, it felt a little silly to me, and I know I'm not denigrating it. It's a great movie, but there was times when I felt like the director didn't, I had to rewrite some of my stuff because some of it just felt silly. Like, and so I didn't say anything that I didn't believe in, but I was, you know, I had to work at that a little bit. Yeah.
And working with young Julia Roberts, did you have any sense that?
Yes, I had a sense she was going to be a huge star. That's not a joke. It's not a joke. It's really? You really did. You knew it. Everybody did. You know, she just had that. Je ne sais quoi. I don't know what all those stars have, but whatever they have, she had it. And so it wasn't surprising to me at all. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Though I didn't know it was going to be Pretty Woman, because I remember we were having coffee. She's like, yeah, I'm doing this movie, Pretty Woman, you know. It's like, cut to, you know, massive. Yeah, but She's great. And, you know, I remember we did a Pret-À-Porter together with Bob Altman in Paris. And I remember we were in the back of a car and the paparazzi was on her and we were racing through Paris. And, you know, they're infamous there. And she was ducking down in the back. And I just thought, Jesus, this feels like a prison, you know? I think Jim Carrey's commented on that. I mean, I'm sure every star who's like at that level, it just becomes, it's hard.
That's certainly something you've never sought out or wanted in your career.
No, and I mean, I couldn't seek it out. It wouldn't happen. I'm like a working actor, you know, that's what I am. And I'm not meant to carry that kind of collective burden or role. It's not even a burden. It's these stars are carrying something for the collective, for society, and they provide a great role, but just so many of them can't bear it, and then they end up dying early, as we can see. Mm-hmm. So thankfully, a lot haven't. Julia Roberts didn't. So many haven't, but as you can see, a lot have. You know.
On a happier subject. Let's
yeah.
Moving back to Say Anything. Again, just a fantastic movie. Can you give a shout out to Say Anything?
Okay. Thank you.
So that came out of your relationship with John Cusack?
Yeah, it did. I guess I'd met somehow Cameron Crowe through John, and then I auditioned and had to, you know, show him I can do it and did it.
And talk about the experience of making that movie.
Fantastic. I mean, Cameron, I mean, he was just coming off Fast Times at Ridgemont High, and he was, you know, Rolling Stone journalist. Nancy Wilson is his wife, or was at the time, and it just felt really exciting. It just felt like, you know, he felt like a great voice for a younger generation, you know.
And again, any sense that movie would become the phenomenon it was?
That I kind of thought there, because he just seemed like he really got young people, you mm-hmm. know. And I mean, for Fast Times at Ridgemont High, and for the Rolling Stone piece prior to that, he was pretending he was a kid in high school and going undercover, you know. Mm-hmm. He knew the young person, you know.
Talk about working with John Cusack. I mean, it sounds like you were friends with him before.
John and I both trained with the Pivens. John grew up in Evanston. I grew up about 20 minutes away. And so we had the same age. And so John and I kind of been crossing paths since, oh, you know, I mean, like, I started with the Pivens in probably sixth grade. Mm-hmm. And so we'd known each other, but kind of. But then we really met when I was about 16.
How do those relationships serve you throughout your career?
Well, you know, in some ways, it's like actors are like gypsies, I think. You know, it's like summer camp. It's like you're really close, and it's very intense and forever, and then you go off, and you're on with the next very intense forever, and then and then you can just get back to the last one, like, oh my God, you're back to get. Because I feel like actors are just always playing. You know, we're just like, we're great, I think. I think we just sort of are up for anything, and, you know, are open, and so it's sort of like you just sort of play with your friends when you meet them, and when you're not with your friends, you're playing with another friend, you know?
You mentioned that you had to audition. Talk about the auditioning process for you. Is that a challenge for you? Do you find it easy? How do you approach it?
It's totally not natural. It's totally not in right order, and maybe there'll be a new process developed in 50 years, which would be amazing. Maybe. I mean, things are moving so fast. Why wouldn't that make an evolutionary turn as well, you know? So it's a totally bad thing. And hard for, I think, a human being to shine. But this is where I've kind of found something that works for me now. So I don't know if you guys know that app, Rehearsal. It's about $20. It's totally worth it. I use it for everything, and I've emailed the creator. He doesn't know who I am or anything. I'm just sort of a nerd, just like, you need to improve this, and that, and this, and that. And supposedly he's developing the app, and I'm on the Kickstarter campaign, and, you know, trying
That's
to get
amazing.
This app out, you know, because it's a great app, but it does need some work. But anyway, so here's the thing. What's great about it is you send your sides to the app, and you can, it has a highlighter, so you highlight your lines, and then you can black them out, and then you can also just touch them if you need to see the lines. But the best thing is you can record. And so what you do is you record your voice low, and you record the other character's voice loud so you can hear it, and then you have basically a scene partner. And I've gotten movies this way, you know, because I'm actually more comfortable with myself than going in a white room with an intern or somebody who's not, doesn't really want to be there. I'd much rather be with myself in my apartment, putting some emotion into it. And sure. I got The Conjuring that way. That's, I did The Conjuring in my apartment with that damn app. Because I was so comfortable. Yeah. But what it is that basically it just keeps going. It's like on auto repeat. So, you know, and I guess that would be like Meisner's thing, is just the repetition, you know? And so I'm just doing it constantly, and that has saved my ass. I mean, when I was doing Almost Human, this show in Vancouver, a J.J. Abrams show, it just went for a year, but the pages were coming in every day, like 20 new pages. And one day there was like a huge monologue, and I had like 1 hour. And I've learned this new thing of memorizing. When you were saying, have you found new things that have worked for you? I've kind of found this way of memorizing that is working for me. And it's sort of a compilation of a little bit of that I've read about mnemonics, a little bit of neurology, of repetition. And what I do, and there's no scientific proof behind my thing, but it has worked, is that what I do is quickly, if it's dialogue, I quickly do the rehearsal app, and I just, you know, and I keep doing that. But for this monologue, what I do is I say the line, like, I walk the dog, 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 I walk the dog. I say that, like, fast, 15 times. Then I go on to the next line, the camera's there, the camera's there, the camera's there, the camera's there. Then I go back to, I walk the dog, the camera's there, I walk the dog, the camera's there. And I do that for the whole thing really fast. Now, when I did this as an experiment for that monologue that I was about to film in like 30 minutes, and I thought, it was more like I was just jumping into like, I'll see if this works, and it did, and I couldn't believe it, and I didn't know what the hell I was doing, but the lines kept coming out, I was like, it worked. And so I've done that. It may not work for you, but there is something they say about repetition, you know, and so anyways, that's my thing about back to auditioning, rehearsal, $20 worth the investment.
Bravo. Has it changed at a point in your career where you just get roles that come to you?
Not really.
Really?
Not really. I mean, I'm auditioning. I'm even getting these things that I just found out are called dummy sides. Hmm. I guess they're dummy sides. Either they're sides that don't have anything to do with the thing you're doing, or they're sides, or they're, you're auditioning for something that there's someone already cast. I don't know what dummy sides mean, but it doesn't sound good to me. And I mean, it's like, it's crazy business.
This is a little bit nice.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there something that you look for in a part? What makes you say that yes, that you want to take something on?
The director.
Really?
Yeah, because in a way it's like, it doesn't matter if it's a great part, who cares? Like, then I can just do, why don't I just do an acting exercise or invite people over to my apartment and do a scene or something. You know, it's like, first of all, if the whole thing isn't good, it'll never really come out, right? Or it won't be seen. So it's in a vacuum. Who cares? It's like the whole thing has to be there because it's just, then it just doesn't matter to me, because what matters to me is the collaboration. And that's, I think, why I say director, because it's the collaboration that's exciting. That being said, it's not like I want to just keep doing like mini supporting roles. I mean, I would like something to bite into, you know? That's really important too, because there was a time when I was doing a lot of like ensembles, and I love ensembles, but I needed to also do something where I had a little bit more, because it's hard when you're doing a smaller part, because then I'm not as connected. It's almost like that double Dutch thing, like when to jump in, playing rope, you're off for 4 days, you're not connected, you come back. It's hard. So I like when it's a more to do because I'm more gotten more connected, you know.
Right. I mean, you mentioned you'd worked in Robert Altman's movies.
Right. But then again, what's interesting about those, they didn't feel like ensembles because he's so, he wants you around all the time, you mm-hmm. know, and he invites you, he would invite you over for dailies and you'd have popcorn and, you know, it was like a beautiful process, you know.
So let's move on to, I just want to make sure we hit on all of your movies.
Sure.
Because I feel like such pressure here. I've got a long list.
Sorry.
No, it's all right. I've got a list. I've got a clock. All right, let's talk about Born on 4th of July when working with Oliver Stone. What was that experience like?
Well, now that was tricky because I was in Chicago for some reason, and I had to fly in and see him on my dime, and he was sort of not being very nice in the audition, and I was sort of like, you know, I've come here, it's hot, it was a heat wave or something. I'm like, I'm hot, and I'm, you know, hey, let's have a little here, a little attention, a little, and I think that was how he liked stuff, so then I got the job, and that sort of attitude throughout the shoot helped. He would give me shit, I'd say, and we would, you know, and it was fine, and that worked for him, you know? Like, he'd say, yeah, you look really great, and I'm like, yeah, I don't have any makeup on for you, man, for your this character. You know, come on, help me out here. So.
It obviously worked.
It worked, and, you know, I mean, Tom Cruise was right there. I loved Risky Business, so that was a huge thing for me. I had a huge crush on him, so that was pretty cool. And Oliver Stone, man, I mean, Salvador, I loved Stone.
So let's talk about I Shot Andy Warhol. How did that project come to you?
You know, Mary Harron, I mean, a great director, New York, I'm New York. She had imagined me in the part, so that was one of those where, you know, she, you know, came to me, but totally independent movie. A really important experience for me in my life. You know, playing a character that was only written about in like two books. So really all of Mary's research, you know, and boxes of her research. And it was a talk about collaborative. It was just a real collaborative experience. It was when the independents were sort of at their height in New York, and it was just great. Christine Vachon, an amazing independent producer, fantastic experience.
How did you even begin to get into that character?
That was hard. That was a real hard one. You know, that one didn't come together really till the night before shooting. And it was this thing that came to me, which was a clear vision in a crippled psyche. That was the last thing that was sort of the unifying principle for her. I mean, because like up until the last day, I couldn't really imagine seeing her eat cereal or have breakfast. You know those, like, when you can't see a character doing kind of everyday things, which is a problem because it's sort of like, then they're not real to me. And that she has a sense of humor. And that's when it came together for me. But it's scary because playing a paranoid schizophrenic is scary because I had to get my bearings. Because I can't go there if I'm not steady. And just like even with The Conjuring too, like going to that other side, which is sort of that other, it's not even animal, it's something in between. And it's scary. And, you know, I have to know that my feet are on the ground and that I'm here and that I'm going to be okay. And so there's a lot of talking to either the character or talking to myself. A lot of times I'll talk to the character and I'll say, like, listen, we're going to start and we're going to go and we're going to be together for a little while and then I'm going to leave you at the end of the day, you know, mm-hmm. which happens with theater, which is great because that's the expression of wiping your feet at the stage door. And there's a reason for that because the whole reason the Greeks came up with the masks was also to protect the actor from the character. So,
really?
Yeah, and so theater has rituals where we do things to help protect us. We don't say that's what it is, but wipe your feet at the stage door, and I think it's to leave the self out, and it's also to then let the character in. Conversely, when you leave, you let the character stay there, so you're not carrying around this. Because like these method actors I think are amazing, Daniel Day-Lewis and so on, I couldn't do that. I need to really make a clear line, or I will end up in a mental hospital. You know, that's just who I am. So, for instance, with Valerie, I had to make sure she didn't take over. Mm-hmm. You know.
I mean, that must have been such a difficult shoot.
It really was. It really was, because we had no money, so I'm in tough conditions. That's when I came up with. On my contract, I need a room with a door that closes. And even they came up with one time just a prop door. I was like, okay, fine. You know, black wrap and then the prop door, whatever. It's fine. We couldn't get a room with a door that closes on the other shoot. But it was hard. It was hard. All the more reason to be grounded and to be, know what I'm doing. You know, so I don't just go like... off.
Was that the most challenging role of your career?
That was up there for sure. The addiction was hard. I played a vampire. That's hard. And Abel Ferrara was, a junkie. And that was hard. Warhol was really tough. But see, the thing is gratifying too. Because I've got so much coming back to me, mm-hmm. collaboration-wise, which helps outweigh the difficulty.
It seems like collaboration is really important to you.
Yeah, it is. It really is.
Can you think of other experiences you've had throughout your career where you've been able to work like that with a writer or a director?
American Crime. Mm-hmm. I mean, John Ridley. Thank you. Yeah. John Ridley is amazing. You know, if you ever cross paths, he's so amazing. And collaboration is very important to him too. So right there, I had a kindred spirit, and mm-hmm. That was very difficult. That was a hard because what she had to go through was just so heartbreaking. And what I was getting back from him helped outweigh the heartbreak. You know, mm-hmm. it just helped balance it out.
I want to come back to
Sorry.
Her later.
Yeah.
No, it's okay.
Jumped. Yeah.
No, it's okay. I walked into that trap when I brought up collaboration. I knew you were going to go to John Ridley. But I do want to talk to you about your balance between independent movies and big, mm-hmm. big budget movies. It seems like you feel equally comfortable in both worlds. Is that a conscious choice you've made, or you go where the best project is?
I try to go where the best one is, but it's like, I've come to see that money, it's not the money or the amount, it's where the control is. And so, for instance, The Conjuring, there was, a pretty decent budget, not crazy, but James Wan had the control. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, I would probably do a big movie just because you need to do big movies. And I don't know if I'd be as picky about it and just sort of cut my losses and say, yeah, this sucks, but I'm doing it, But there is a price to be paid in that. I think it's hard. For me, I don't love with the big movies how there's all these lines of demarcation, and and there doesn't feel like there's a big collaboration because everybody's got, no, you don't pick up that Apple box. No, don't, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Whereas like American Crime, it was ABC, it was money, but yet I could pick up an Apple box or be sitting on the floor and no one would say, it was fine. You know what I mean? Because we're all mm-hmm. in it together. So I just think the thing with big movies is just to watch out for, the big forces and to either know that you may not have a say, or if you have a say, you might have to fight for it. And that's it. Yeah.
I mean, over the course of your career, you've certainly seen an evolution in television. I mean, roles that weren't existing before kind of do exist now.
Oh yeah, I mean it's been a huge evolution in television, and I do think that it's better for women. It's still got a lot of work to do. Everything does, but it's better than film. And I think it's like a 40% roles for women in TV versus 10% in film, something like that. I don't have it perfectly right with the stats, but. And I think for men too. I just think there's more interesting stuff because I think people can take more risks on TV. And I remember when a friend of mine did Sopranos and I thought it was like, you're doing a show for HBO? You know, I remember HBO had offered us money at one point. I was going to do the Janis Joplin, and they offered us money, and we were like, no, we can't. HBO's offering us money. You know, it's like, Jesus Christ. little did we know that they were the beginning of the revolution. And it's been so great, as we can all see. I mean, for actors, it's great. For creators, it's great. And for the public, it's great. Mm-hmm. I mean, the public is getting good food. And I think that's helped everybody see that people like stories. And yeah, still 20 million people will tune into The Bachelorette, but a lot of people also want stories. Mm-hmm. And maybe they'll do The Bachelorette and they'll also do stories, you know?
Right.
And so it's been great for everybody, you know? And thank God is all I have to say.
So speaking of HBO, there was a show called 6 Feet Under.
Yep, part of it. Yep. Yep. Yeah, I mean, exactly. And that show, it was like, yeah, you know, I mean, whereas before doing TV, I remember I was doing a play with Calista Flockhart. And she went off, she had to leave the play we were doing for Ally McBeal. And that was still before TV had changed, because there was a time when TV hurt your career. Mm-hmm. And now you get movies from TV, it's crazy. But we were sort of making fun of Calista, like, Ally McBeal, you know, we were making fun of her, you know, but we were also like, of course, go off and do whatever. But, you know, but so by 6 Feet Under, it was still like, you know, I still wasn't sure about TV, but obviously it was like, yeah. I mean, I thought I wanted to just do some guest stars, because also I lived in New York, it was here. And I was only supposed to do 4, and then they said, you're pregnant. So I was like, oh, okay, I guess I'm coming back. So, oh,
by
well.
The way.
All right, I'll commute, you know, yeah.
So how did the part come to you?
You know, Alan Ball, he sort of had sort of imagined it, and it was amazing, because what I like about TV is that it is a lot like theater in that the writer has the control and the writer has the say. And you respect the lines, and I love that. So when I did 6 Feet Under, it really felt like doing like one-act plays mm-hmm. once a week. And it was great to be in such just a strong art. You could feel it.
It was amazing. I ended up rewatching some of your episodes this weekend, and it still holds up. I mean, it was so, just phenomenal. The writing, the directing, the acting. I mean, it really was a harbinger of things to come.
I do think so. And I think that what we're seeing with TV, when there are these great showrunners, everything is so, you could answer these, and most of them are men, but you could ask them anything and they would have an answer. Anything. That's how well they know their world. And we're talking about Simon, we're talking about Chase. Mm-hmm. Ridley, I think, is now one of them.
Definitely.
Vince Gilligan. They are, I don't even understand what they do. Their minds are like on another level. I so admire it. And Ball had that. He had, everything was a house of cards. Everything was thought out. Everything was specific. Cared about. It's like the care Pixar takes in their, it's the same care. When I watch a Pixar movie, I know every single thing has been thought out. And if there's any question I have, if I go online and say, it will be answered, you know? And I just love that. And just to jump to Ridley for just 1 second, I remember I didn't understand something he had written, and I thought, I don't know, I didn't believe, it. Something didn't feel, there felt like there was some step had been missed. And I emailed him because he said, you are welcome to email me anytime. And I just said, I just don't know why she's, and he had a whole paragraph. And I was like, done. Done.
He talks in paragraphs.
Yeah. Yeah, beautiful paragraphs.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
I know. Every time I talk to him, he talks in a paragraph and I just literally have to print it because I can't edit it. It's just simply a paragraph.
Right.
Just back to 6 Feet Under for one quick question. Sure. Talk about working with Peter Krause. What was that experience like?
It was great. I mean, that's who my stuff was with. And he was a beautiful actor, totally receptive, collaborative, again, there's the word. But just lovely, lovely.
I do want to talk a little bit about your penchant for horror movies. What is it that draws you to horror movies?
Well, I love them, and I think they are important for the collective, and in fact, I don't know where I read this, and I do need to find it because I've used it a few times, that some studies found that people who leave a horror movie, it's as if they've been to the gym.
And I love that.
I buy it. I think there's something, it makes sense. Why wouldn't we need to get all these fears out in a safe place? It's like when a kid, you know, plays hide and seek. You know, they need that thrill of knowing the parent might be gone, but they also know the parent's going to be there. It's totally safe, you know. And I think we need it. And I love if someone does it well. If someone does anything well, I want to be there. And James Wan can do anything well. And when I heard he was doing the Fast and Furious, I was like, this Fast and Furious is probably going to be the best Fast and Furious ever, you know. And I just loved working. I mean, I just knew it was going to be scary. When we were filming that, I knew it was going to be good. I just knew it. I'd be surprised if it wasn't going to be good.
Do you get scared?
Watching it, yes. I've screamed just as much as someone else. And in fact, I heard I screamed more in one screening. And one kind of thing than anybody else is when Bathsheba jumped from the top of the cabinet. I mean, that says so much about James Wan. I know exactly what's happening, and yet he's so in the unconscious that I'm terrified.
As an actor, how do you prepare for a role like that? It's not like you can do research.
Oh, you can.
Oh.
Oh, you can. Oh, on that, yeah, because I needed to do research on what I realized is because my character was possessed, is exorcisms.
Oh, of course.
And what's possession? You know, drug addicts who are under the influence and exorcisms, which is I don't recommend at all. They are out there and they're really painful. And then James Wan is going to do all the work in terms of the scares. But why that movie I think was so good also is because it was all practical effects. There was no CGI, you know, and James also knew, just like, you know, The Exorcist and Rosemary's Baby, that it comes from relationships and from performance. That's what really, and I think everyone's getting that now. I think the investors, I think the public has known all along that they want to see, they don't want so much CGI, you know, they want to see the stuff happening.
It makes such a difference. And I'm sure it makes a difference for you as a performer as well.
Well, exactly. So when you say, how did I prepare? Like, I just had acting stuff I needed to prepare for, but it was all happening for me. So James helped create it for me. So I didn't have to do that much work in a way, you know? I just had to respond. And that in itself is very difficult. To how do you respond? How do you be there on a day of filming and respond? It's difficult not react, you know? It's hard.
We haven't talked at all, I realize, about your rehearsal process. What happens when you get on a set? Do you rehearse? Do you rehearse with actors, or is it different on every show or film you work on?
Well, usually with film, you don't get to rehearse because it's just not valued, you know, and everything's kind of about money. And so, and it takes a director who either has a producer who really understands that and is like, gets that week of rehearsal, which is amazing when you do get it. I mean, I just think you can't lose with rehearsal. And I love it, but I don't expect it. And then with theater, of course, it's everything. And
right.
But so I try to do what I can. You know, sometimes I'll rent a room out, and I'll work out some stuff in a room, you know, just to make sure that I'm getting it, you know. And then we start filming, and hopefully I've got the character. Yeah.
But on TV shows, does that ever happen? Do you get time for rehearsal on TV?
You know, John, we were able to like work out stuff with John, little almost like sit down stuff with John, because either the sets aren't built,
right.
So you don't have some of the things you need, you know, to rehearse.
So I want to move on quickly just to Almost Human, because I read something interesting that the part was written for a man.
Yeah, my manager was like, what about Lili Taylor? Why can't, you know, can you? And so, and then I got the audition, and then that happened, and it was great.
Were you intimidated at all by the idea of taking on a part that was written for a man? Or
no, not at all. Because we should take a lot of male roles and make them female.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, like half of them. Like, there's no reason. We're over half the planet. I don't understand why. And we make up more than half the buying audience for tickets. What the heck? Come on, man.
Did they change the character at all, or it just went through as the character was written?
Probably didn't change it too much.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Do you like sci-fi? Or?
No, but I'm open to it. I just need education. I just need, like, give me the top three books I should read, the top three movies, boom, I'm there, you know. But it's not what I naturally go to.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick word about Ransom. Talk about working with Mel Gibson.
Well, I mean, I didn't have much with Mel because I was talking to him on the phone saying, I got your fucking kid, you know? So I didn't have much. There was only one scene. You know, he was shorter than I thought. I did not see what came later. Did not see that at all. He baffles me. I don't understand.
Yeah.
But, you know, some of his movies have been really interesting.
Fair enough.
So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know, Mel. Just keep it together.
Okay.
Look, I think any kind of high religiosity can sort of make a split.
Right.
And I think that happens, and maybe there was a split. Too much repression isn't healthy.
Other than that, how was the experience for you of making Ransom?
Great.
Okay, good. Let's leave that one on a positive
note. It's fun to be
a
bad guy. Yeah.
All right, so let's move on to American Crime, because I just want to talk about John Ridley.
Yeah, okay.
How did that come to you? Let's even talk at the beginning, you know, the whole project of American Crime, starting with the first season.
Well, so John, I guess, you know, maybe it sensed a kindred spirit, and he sort of was like, would you like to play this part? And it was one of the few things I've been offered, you know, and I was like, yeah, and it was great. And I just knew this was a great thing. I just knew it. You know, look, John gathers everybody together, the whole crew, from catering to everybody, and just says, I want everybody to know you are of value. I respect what you're doing. Thank you. Let's begin. I mean, come on. I mean,
yeah.
It's like...
Nothing else like it.
I mean, it's like, he's such a great man. He's a great man. But conversely, he's like, but I expect. You know? But that's great, because everybody does better when more is expected of them. You know, when you're playing with a better player than you, your game goes up. You know, it just happens. That's how we work.
In talking with other actors, it just seems like it's a very different experience than any other TV show, that you just sort of get pages, you know, right before you're going to start shooting. It's not exactly clear to you where your character is going to go. What's that experience like for you on your side of it?
Well, okay. I mean, like, I didn't know where things were going, but I knew that everything I needed to know, I would know, and what I didn't need to know, I wouldn't. Mm-hmm. And, like, scripts 4 through 9 were redacted, like a CIA document. And, you know, TV's hard because a lot of times you don't know, and it's what's like life, and I think that's exactly why John was doing it. Mm-hmm. And I think that for me, that's hard, because to me, like, creating a character is a lot like a house of cards. And for instance, if I'd known that a character was going to become a psychopath, I might have made different choices early on. You know what I mean? But you just have to trust and just know, like life, sometimes it throws you a curveball and you go another way that you didn't think you would go. And there's no better person to trust than John Ridley, so.
What was the experience like on set with working with the rest of the ensemble?
I mean, a joy. I mean, most of my stuff was with Connor Jessup, who played my son, and he's a beautiful actor, as you can see. He's like a river phoenix. His feelings are right there. He's beautiful. He's receptive. Lovely, loving. We both knew we just had we knew we were really lucky to be with each other.
How did you find your way into that character? I mean, she was so damaged, and it must have been a challenge for you.
It was. I mean, and that was a case where, you know, not a lot of research. You know, that was a case where I needed to be, you know, I'm from Chicago. It took place in Indiana. I know Midwestern women like that. You know, a working class. She felt familiar to me in some ways. I have a child. That felt familiar. And so it was really imagination. And John, you know, if you have a good writer, it's all going to be there for you. And so I just had to imagine and be there and give it my all.
I know you were also part of the ensemble in season one. How did season one for you compare to season two?
Well, that's that thing where, you know, that was a supporting role. I'm fine. It was great. I was fine. But, of course, it's no comparison to last season because there's so much for me to think about and do. And it's just my neurons are firing more.
Sure.
You know, they just are, mm-hmm. You know.
What do you think of this model of, like, taking the, you know, it's sort of like a troupe of actors and kind of reinventing them and giving them new roles? I mean, it just seems like such an exciting time for television.
It is, and I think that it's a model that is kind of old, and actors have been doing in theater for so long, and I think it's a win-win because I think that a shorthand gets developed. The writers get to know the actor, the directors get to know the writers. So, and then what the audience starts to get is a much richer product. And it's just like when I saw the Steppenwolf, Osage County. Yes. You can't, being together 20 years, you can't, what they have is it's a canvas that's just, it's as if the canvas has just so many more layers of paint, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? And hence pigment and hence character and so on. You just can't, so the people are getting more. So it's a win-win. So I think people are going to, I'm sure people are going to do it more because it's just better.
I mean, and this was also such a, I mean, every season, look, of American Crime, John has really tapped into big issues, but I think the audience really responded so much more to this season. How did you feel about it, sort of, you know, from the audience response standpoint?
I felt a real connection when people were talking to me. It started with a flight attendant for some reason. I don't know why I was having to do a lot of flying. And, well, because I was commuting, that's why, to Austin. And you know, a lot of parents were telling me that they just were going through similar things, you know, or were scared of what was to come, you know, social media-wise. And I think that with the sports and with the male stuff, the class stuff, I think what John learned from season one to season two, I think he found that whenever he was going into like ideas, he caught himself. And he would say, this is an idea. I have to get this into emotion and into feeling. And I think that that is always more effective. I know when someone's talking to me, I'm shut down. It's just like, you know, I'm not here as much, you know, in the heart or in the gut. And I remember when John, we were reading through something and I had this feeling like about a line that was like, you know, and I was gonna say something because I knew I could. But then we ended and he was like, you know what? That's not right. I gotta work on that. It was like, how often does that happen where you have this thing where you're, that's like, and it was an idea. The line was an idea. And he made it into a feeling.
How rare is it to find this on network television?
Well, that's a whole other issue. So we're talking about TV, and now we're talking about network TV.
Right.
You know, and I think that ABC, I really take my hat off to them because it's hard. It's courageous to take a leap like this, especially when your money comes from, you know, your capital comes from a certain place, and here you are doing something that's, you know, may not make the capital back as much, or the people that make the capital, or however the hell the whole system works, mm-hmm. may not work as well. And here they are doing it, and because I think they know though that the model is they will become a dinosaur if they don't, mm-hmm. you know, and it's just the way it's happening, and they get it, and they're the first ones to jump on board and do it.
When you look back over the course of the season, was there a moment that was particularly challenging for you?
A lot of it felt really hard. I would probably say technically and emotionally, episode 7, when my son comes to me and, you know, says that I've shot somebody, that was all one shot. and it was, and it was so it was continuous. I don't know, a 5-page scene. Yeah. So one shot is that's all you have. You can't have nothing to cut into. So it has to be absolutely perfect. So you have to work with the camera. You have to work with the dolly grip. You have to work like a dance. So you have to rehearse. And you know, John was great. He said, you know, if this doesn't work, we'll throw it out and we'll shoot it how you normally would, which I think is so great. Again, it's that idea thing. If it felt like we were imposing something, John was going to just nix it. But it was authentic. What he was hoping to get from that was a real lifelike feeling, which I think totally you got. It was in the moment, you know. Mm-hmm. And then that feeling, that thing of having to turn my son in was very difficult to just understand that mental process, how she got there, the thinking of getting there was tough. So that was a tiring day.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
One of the things I've heard him say is the reason he gives you redacted scripts is he wants to get your honest emotion. I would imagine that's got to be emotionally exhausting to perform as an actor.
It is. It's hard. And I mean, but see, the thing is, though, is that I have my lines. I'm getting my lines, thank mm-hmm. God. But I don't know what's happening around me. Mm-hmm. So that's like, I don't know how anyone else is responding to my character.
Right. So, but that's what, you
know, and that's like life.
That's life.
Yeah.
Yeah. If God willing, there's a third season. Would you return for it?
Oh God, yeah. Oh, without. I mean, I would anything. Mm-hmm. And I don't expect, you know, if it's someone else's turn and I'm down, you know, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the other side of, I guess, of a repertoire company is you gotta, okay, I'll be the swordsman, you know, I'll be the guard, you know.
Anything else about American Crime I haven't asked you that you? I feel like we've exhausted American Crime.
I don't think so.
But it's, you know, I mean, it's just such a tremendous show.
Thank you. It's been really neat to work on a show that feels so much good stuff coming back, you know, where it's like, because it's not often things get nailed, you know, and it's like, wow, they did it. They did a show that people really are like, you know, yes, this is really impacting me. Thank you.
And I feel like audiences have responded to that and they've recognized it. And it's just, I mean, it is a real rarity for broadcast television.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, hats off to the cast and certainly Don Ridley as well.
And ABC.
Yeah.
I did not feel like, we kept saying, is this an ABC show? Mm-hmm. It's like, and John would say, don't ask. Just let's keep doing. I don't know why this is happening like this because no one was breathing down our necks. It was amazing.
So when you look to what you want to do next, I mean, I know you've talked about various stages of your career, preferring film versus TV versus stage. What factors into your decision about what you would want to do next?
I mean, what I would like is just more opportunity, you know, like more chances to do things, more, you know, I just want to do more. You know, I want to work. I want to do good stuff. I just want to do good stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'd like to try my hand at a musical. I would like to try to push things, to push genres, see how what we can do with things and try different things.
A musical, really?
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yeah.
What have you learned? What have you learned throughout your career?
A lot. I've learned that to thine own self be true. This too shall pass. Both ways. Mm. Both ways, for sure. That a career has ebbs and flows. And that it can be long.
I want to get some of the questions in from the audience. Right, we did this one, sorry. Sahar wants to know, what character have you connected to the most in your career and why?
Connected to the most? God, that's a good one. I don't know. it's, and I wish I knew because I try to bring myself in, and then I'm wondering, have I brought myself in enough? If I haven't connected to somebody enough, one of the characters. I guess because I don't think about it as much as how we're connecting, me and the character, but more just like, am I channeling her? Do you know? Or am I listening to her well enough? Because like I can be connecting to her, but I might not be listening to her. Do you know? I don't know if I'm explaining that right, but I could say that the gentlest character was Rose from Dogfight. I mean, that was the character. A lot of my characters, I'm kind of like, God, you're harsh, you know? Because they're nasty to me sometimes, and I have to say, hey, easy, I'm playing you. You know, if you don't get a little nicer, I'm not going to play you, you know? But Rose was so nice, you know? I was just like, she was such a sweetheart. So she was the sweetest one. How about I twist it around that way?
Well done. I like that. All right, this one's from Seth Bloom. Was there ever a low point in your acting career in the beginning or early on when jobs were few and far between?
At the beginning? Low point, the low point recently. No, I feel like I've had more low points later. I didn't have them earlier. I mean, I did. Okay, don't read reviews. That's one thing I'll say. That's something I've learned. And you know, Olivier saying of check your props, you know, I kind of was like, wow, that's all he came up with? Like, I thought he would have come up with something so deep. But you know what? It's fucking true. Mm-hmm. And I will say, check your props. Now with movies, it's not quite as important because you've got props there and so on. But there have been important takes where the props weren't checked. And we lost the take because the prop, and of course with theater, well, there's no fucking there. If the prop's not there, you're really fucked. So, you know, I have to say, check your props. And in fact, that just happened to me on something. I was like, check your props. Mm. The thing wasn't, it wasn't there. And anyway, but so check your props. Don't read the reviews, I think, because that was a low point when I read a review. Oh my God. But I've had more low points because, but the youth sort of helped. You know, and because I knew, well, I'm, you know, I could imagine distance or imagine things to make up for that. But then when I get older, it's sort of like, uh-oh, you know, if things don't change. Anyways, it's just a little harder getting older. So just hang in there when you get older.
This one's from Victor. What would you have done differently if you weren't an actress?
You mean like what would I have done?
Yeah.
Well, I would be, I'd be an ornithologist, I think, or something to do with birds.
Wow. Okay, this one's from Nadia. What would you say has been the major difference for women in this business over the past 5 years?
That it's probably gotten worse. No, I think that, and in some ways it has.
How so?
Yeah. You didn't know that it took a little slide down? It's bad out there. It's really bad. And we need to start talking about it. And it's not chicks complaining. There's some real issues. In some ways, Hollywood is can be like a mirror for the rest of society, and I think it can bring about change. And so why don't we start to get the ball rolling here and start to show that, you know, I just wrote an essay about it. Like, if Hollywood is a mirror, and if yet women are underrepresented, which we are, how are we going to find out? If they're invisible, how are we going to learn about who we are, what we are, that we need help, that there's not enough of us out here in front? But it's got to change in big ways, and it really has to change. It's all kind of gender bias, and it basically has to change at the top, you know? And so the people in the boardroom have to start getting more women on the boards, and the people who are running the companies need to start people getting on into their companies that know how to handle gender bias and get people's hardcore training in there to figure out how we change people who hire and get more women in positions of power. And that's all there is to it. That's when things change.
Absolutely. So on that note, it's a good segue to this one. Richard wants to know, do you have a dream project you would like to create, and who would you want to work with in creating it?
You know, I don't imagine enough. I wish I imagined more. I'm better if you come to me with something. I'm like, great, I'm there. What do you need? I don't know. I wish I had a dream project, though I am working on, I'm about to work on something with this friend, a birder friend, called Wild in the City. So we're going to make like a pitch tape in Central Park, and basically it's just to go to these different cities and to see how wildlife and people are basically, we're living side by side and don't really know it. And there's all these things happening that we don't, I mean, the mountain lion, you've probably heard about here, that's like a kind of a more sexy aspect of wildlife, but on lower levels, it's on more common levels, it's just even noticing that squirrel or the raccoon or how coyotes are adapting, so on. There's a coyote den in Soldier Field in Chicago, you know, and she's raised like three litters, you know, and how? And so anyways, just to go and sort of just so that there's more meaning in our lives when we're walking down the street or driving. And just seeing like, oh, I hadn't ever thought that over there in that ivy, there was all this stuff that was living. So we're gonna start and hopefully do something with this show, Wild in the City, we'll see.
It sounds incredible. So I'm glad over the pat.
Thank you, okay. Woo-hoo!
So I'm glad over the past hour we've had the chance to talk about your incredible career and some amazing projects. As you look back, is there one that you're proudest of or you look back on the most fondly?
Gosh, you know, I'm wondering if it's American Crime now.
Wow.
I think it might be. I think so. Well, okay, John, you did it!
Well, on that note, we're going to end it there. Thank you so much.
Okay, very warm. You guys are great. Thank you.